They're super jacked about that, and it'll be a theme throughout the week, and something that I didn't know much about. And obviously with the situation with our family, losing a child, it wasn't to cancer, but losing a child and then being in the hospital setting for those 40 days still is seared into my brain, my family's brain, and to see what Smile Mile does to serve the families of those dealing with the most difficult circumstance of their life is very special to me, my family, and now our football team. So I'll turn over to Bruce and Kelly to make a statement and answer some questions, and I'll come back after that.
Go ahead, guys.
Thank you, Coach.
I'm Bruce Hooper. I'm the CEO of Smile a Mile, and we are excited this week. Coach, thank you so much. We are filled with gratitude and appreciation. I have never seen the kids and families that we serve as excited about something as they are for Saturday, seeing these cool jerseys. You know, we'll have the names of 100 of the kids that we serve or have served in the past. There will be some families who have lost a child whose name will be on the jerseys. Just a little background on us. We've been around for nearly 40 years. About 17,000 kids in the United States are diagnosed with pediatric cancer every year. Right here in Alabama, about one every other day. So about 200 kids across the state are diagnosed, and I know every one of y'all could think about someone that you know from a child's class, from church, from somewhere. We see them as about 90% of kids are treated right here in our backyard, a rock's throw from y'all and from us at Children's Hospital. At any one time, there are about 500 kids who are going through treatment, about 1,500 across the state who are going through the journey. So I wanted our COO, Kelly Reese, just to talk to you a little bit about how we do what we do for those kids and their families.
Kelly's really boring, so everybody.
Yes,
just,
exactly.
The energy is low.
The energy is low here.
No, thank y'all so much for having us. I get the honor of being able to direct all of our programming and being able to walk out what we do each and every day. I've been around for 25 years. I started as a volunteer, and now I'm on staff. And so we started as a camp. A lot of you may have known us as Camp Smile a Mile years ago. Some of you who go way back in the Birmingham area. But we do far more than that now. We have camps, but we also have our hospital outreach program, which is 10 years old this year, where we are meeting families oftentimes within 24 hours of a diagnosis. So we are with them through the whole journey, whether that is if their child is cured or whether their journey turns a different way. We never leave our families, and as Bruce said, we will have several bereaved families whose survivor siblings are still involved in our programming. And I had a parent say to me how special it was because his child played football before he passed away, and how special it was gonna be to see his child's name on a jersey. And for a lot of these families, that's not an option anymore, whether their child has secondary effects of cancer that allows them to not play contact sports. And so I think it's really special that they get to be honored in that way. And as a parent, and those of you who are parents or uncles or cousins or grandparents in this room, being able to honor these children in a way that is so special means a tremendous amount. So not only do we do the programming at the hospital, we're also across the state. We have kids in every county in this state going through cancer right now, so we take the programming to them so that they don't always have to come to Birmingham. They come here for their medical care, but we don't want them always to have to come here. So the support, just like players from all over the state and all over the country that UAB has, it's really unique to be able to pair these kids together with these young athletes, and so we're just really, really grateful for that. And looking forward to Saturday, we have almost 300 who will be in attendance, so y'all look for us there. You won't be able to miss us. So we're just really excited, and thank y'all again, Coach.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks,
so
Bruce.
If you have a question for any of the three of them, just whoever you have a question for, please come back up to the podium.
Okay.
This is for Bruce. If you I just wonder, just kind of from your perspective, how this partnership came about, and just how did this whole thing start, and And just how much did you know before about the Children's Harbor, and because this is very similar to that?
Right. So we managed to get Coach Dilfer to Smile a Mile Place. We have a 13,000 square foot facility about three blocks from the front door of Children's Hospital. And he, Mark Ingram, I give huge props also to Ted, because Ted's wife is a former junior board president of Smile a Mile. But I think it was an easy sell to Coach Dilfer, as he mentioned. I mean, he has been through bereavement. He understands, you know, what these kids and their families are going through. And, you know, it's going to be an exciting night on Saturday, truly. So we look forward to it.
Could you touch on just what it means to the kids? Football is kind of something that takes their mind.
Yeah, it's, right? You know, so much of what we do, Ryan, is just for those moments, making them and helping them to forget about childhood cancer. From camp, we just want them to be surrounded by other kids who are going through what they are. And during that time, it doesn't matter whether they are bald-headed, whether they're missing a limb, you know, they just get to be a kid. And this is exactly the same thing. I mean, they are so pumped. Like I said, there has not been one thing that has resonated with the kids and families as much as this opportunity on Saturday night to be there. You know, on Thursday at practice, some of them will get the opportunity to meet the player who will be wearing their name on their jersey. So it's just really cool. We are excited. There's going to be a big block of folks there that night representing for Smile a Mile.
So, side note, we're blaming last week's loss on Ted completely. We decided that this morning, but we're giving all credit to this game to Ted. So it's kind of a bad news, good news thing. So I did not know of Smile a Mile. Ted actually was the first person that told me about it, and was immediately intrigued and then passionate about it once I got to meet Bruce and Kelly and be around the facility and see the services they provide for these families is pretty remarkable. So I think this is just the beginning of a lot of cool things we'll do as Blazer football program with Smile a Mile.
And Trent, how important was for you was to do stuff like this, right? When you got in, kind of just jump on in and support the community?
Well, I think number one, you know, when I was building this thing out in my head, I do believe in mission statements. I do think they're the kind of the lighthouse off in the distance, you know, they're the thing you're aiming for. And to have Serve, Grow, Launch as one isn't just a sign on a wall, you know. And I think so often in college football, high school, all levels of football, you get these cool, really cool sayings, really cool mottos, and then there's no action behind it. So, you know, service is the primary thing that I want to run this program on. And to get our kids, our players, our coaches, serving the community, serving those in need, serving mankind in general will only help them serve each other more and serve the program. So it started there. I mean, you know, everybody's talking about recruiting and this and that, and those are all really important things. To me, the urgent thing when I took this job over was the service piece and all of it. I mean, you know the exact numbers, but I think we've already done over 700 hours of service as a program. We're the bulk of the athletic department service hours so far. So they've taken to heart. I mean, I know even as of today, we're lining up trips with Food for Our Journey, players serving our community through Food for Our Journey. So Smile a Mile is just one of the many areas that we want our kids to really pour into the community.
You just talked about kind of jumping right into that whenever you were hired. Is it just more so, you know, your personal experience plus, you know, what Bill Clark did with the foundation? You talk a lot about that, his foundation, and really getting the Children's Harbor game going to really expand upon that.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. You know, Bill, obviously, I've said it a million times, create a great foundation. That's one of the neat things he did through the foundation and through the Children's Harbor game. So wanted to build on top of that, wanted to dedicate this whole season to something bigger than ourselves. So if you've noticed, all six home games between Benevolent Fund, Smile a Mile, and Children's Harbor are dedicated for something bigger than this program. But yes, building upon a foundation that was already solid.
I've been here for about 3 years. I was in Dothan before this, and a lot of patients that are sick come to this city. Did you know about that beforehand? Because I didn't. I think it's fascinating what this city really does. Is that something that you're kind of being new to the city? Like, wow, this is really a special place.
It's one of the many things I love about this city. I've made it very clear I've fallen in love with the city. We'll probably end up here forever. That's just one of the really cool things about it. You know, it's the most charitable city in America, and it's a city that serves. I can't think of two better things to say about a city. We want to be a proud representation of what the city stands for. So that's why we're doing what we're doing. Now we got to win also. That did not happen.
Trent, just a football question for you, if you will. Jacob Zeno has been incredibly efficient. I think he leads the nation, it says, in completions per game. Has he overexceeded maybe your expectations from an efficiency standpoint? And what's the ceiling for him? Do you think he can continue to get even better?
Well, you know, this is a hard question to answer, because the answer to start this after a loss with Jacob playing well, I think, is not representative of how I feel. Yes, he's playing well. Yes, he's been efficient. Yes, the numbers represent that. He also threw an interception in a critical moment, which is just not to our standard, and he knows that. And that's something that, you know, as you look at on film, it doesn't matter how many good things you do if you turn the ball over. And I think that's the message to the offense, is I really don't care about all these numbers. I'd rather be last in the nation in offense and be 2-0 and have zero turnovers. So I think too often in college football, again, this is one of my gripes with it, is people get super excited about numbers. And the only number that matters is the win and loss column. And right now we played losing football offensively. We turned it over 3 times and he was part of that. Now, am I mad at Jacob? No, I think he's playing at a very high level. But I think for us to meet our standard as a program, that needs to be the headliner, is that was losing football in all 3 phases. We lost the field position game, we got gashed on defense, and we turned the ball over on offense. I mean, that is lose, lose, lose. That can't happen. And then we try to mask it with all this cool stuff for social media and recruiting, and I get that. Like, I'm talking to the recruits as well, like, hey, that's not who we are. But at the end of the day, that's losing football. And we have to establish a culture around here, and Bill did it. And it's something that, you know, I feel like I failed the program at, that there was a culture of play clean on offense, stop people on defense, and win the kicking game. That we did 0 of 3 against Georgia Southern, and that has to be fixed. So I'm sorry for being Debbie Downer, but that's just the reality of it, is somebody came and said, well, you know, second in completion percentage and this, that. I'm like, all I see is 3 turnovers. That's all I see. All I see is getting gashed on kickoff return. All I see is, you know, giving up more points than I think we gave up as a team all of last year when I was a coach. So I married a smoke show, and I have awesome kids, and she wasn't as hot, and my kids were annoying, and my food sucked. And that's kind of where I'm at. Now, my grandson's still the best human ever. That didn't change. But my wife knows, my kids know, like, this is not what we signed up for. That is not a representation of anything I believe in, anything that's been preached around here, and it's my job to get it fixed.
Speaking of getting it fixed, with your running game, has it been what people thought it might be going into the season? What
person number one?
Yeah, there you go. What needs to be? What do you need to do better?
Yeah, we have to be more physical with the line of scrimmage. We have better knockback. You know, we lost the knockback game again. You know, and it's 2 weeks in a row we lost the knockback game, and that just can't happen. And again, people are going to say, well, young offensive line, experienced offensive line. Yeah, blah 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 blah. You know, you have a job to do. Knock them back. We got to do a better job of that. Now, I'll give them a lot of credit. They did a really nice job, presenting a profile of kind of being ultra aggressive to take away the run game. It was definitely in their mind that they were not going to let Skoll or Jacob get going. I think they saw the tape of week one. They saw the dynamic qualities those two have. Our ability to run the ball well at times in the first game, and that was direct intent to take that away. So it's one of the reasons why we were able to throw the ball for so many yards, was because they were committed to taking away the run.
would you say that some of the mistakes made on the defensive side of the ball are fixable?
I think everything's fixable. That is the bright side. I talked to a couple players yesterday, and I said, now, I've been on teams where they weren't fixable. I don't want to say anything bad about players, but I remember one year we started with a seventh wide receiver that we had started at the X position, and he was worse than any college receiver I had played with. And I was like, that's not fixable. He's not going to get open. Like, there's just nothing we can do about it. I played with, you know, your third practice squad right guard, where it doesn't matter how much we want that to get better, he's going to get beat, right? That's not the case here. There's not a single thing that isn't fixable, and that isn't fixable quickly. These are not long-term developmental fixes. These are immediate, like tomorrow fixes. And I think there's equal burden to be shared, right? We have to do a better job as coaches. I always start there. The coaches know that I will be harder on them than I am the player. We have to give them better information. We have to coach them better. We have to find more creative ways of getting the messaging through. Whatever it takes, we have to do as coaches. But then players, they need to respond more. They need to do their jobs in a higher manner. So in a more highly detailed manner. But those are very doable things. And I do think the want to is there. You know, I mean, I know the want to is there. It's the know how to that we're trying to get them to make stickier, I guess, is the way I would say it.
Coach, we've talked with you all off season, and you always say it. I'm 0-0. No, I haven't coached a game yet. Your first loss. How is this
in 2 years, by the way?
In 2 years. How have
I haven't lost a football game in 2 years. It was a numbing feeling.
Yeah. What is that like for you? And then I want to ask about the biggest thing is the reaction of your staff and your players, because I feel like that defines the future as well. Yep. Is how you react to the loss.
I'd use the word respond. That's what I talked to them about is, you know, when you're reactionary, you tend to make knee-jerk decisions. When you respond, it's tactical. It's well thought out. There's less emotion, more matter-of-factness to it. In fact, it goes to our off-season. We had Team Red, White, and Blue come in and train the boys twice. They talked a lot about the difference between reaction and responding in special operators' lives. So we want to take that approach. We want to respond at a high level. We did started yesterday. You know, we worked yesterday and got after it and had a lot of growth, I think. I think the first part of the question was, what did it feel like and how do we handle that? It was numbing that night just because it's been so long since I've been part of loss. But I've been part of lots of losses now. It didn't take long to remember what it felt like to lose. Woke up yesterday morning sick to my stomach for all the things that I could do better. You know, I always feel a burden as a leader that I could have done so much better in the week of preparation and during the game. And then you go to work at fixing those things, and that's the responding. And I think yesterday was a vibrant day as a staff. I think as players, they really appreciated the teaching behind yesterday, the correction, instead of the hooping and hollering and throwing things and getting angry and the blame game. You know, the blame game didn't happen. We looked at it with a very critical eye, but through an educator's eye. And then last night, you know, we had a really good practice. You know, it's not a hard practice by any stretch of the imagination, but it's one where you have to be attentive. Focus is at a premium. Emotions have to kind of go away. Because you remember, you have guys that feel as if they could have helped us win that game and they didn't play as much. You have to take into account of a lot of people's different perspectives and emotions. And I thought they were able to table those and do what was best for the program last night. So I do feel like we took a step forward yesterday and tonight, but again, those are just words until we go out there on Saturday and play a much higher level of football.
So no NFL football yesterday?
No, in fact, it was funny. I was walking Nala this morning at 6-ish and I saw Nick Coleman out there running and I was looking at my phone. And I'm not on my phone a lot. If you guys notice, I'm not a guy that sits there on my phone. So I was on my phone and he kind of looked at me and I said, I'm checking on NFL scores. I don't know what happened yesterday. It was the first Sunday, since 1994, that I hadn't been completely invested in Sunday football. So it was a new day for me. Even last year when I was coaching high school football, I would prep in my office on Sundays after church and have three games on because I spoke about them on Monday with Colin Coward or Ryan Russillo or whatever. So it was the first. I had zero idea. I saw through Instagram that Tua threw for 450 yards. I had forgotten that C.J. Stroud was the starting quarterback for the Texans. What else was funny yesterday? I'd forgot that Derek Carr was with New Orleans and he's a friend of mine. There was a lot of stuff. I was like, what? I was kind of doing the Bleacher Report, like score, stats. I'm like, he plays for them? I mean, it's been a whole offseason that I've been detached from the NFL. So it was very odd.
You sort of answered the question, but, you know, responding in a more tactical way. But, you know, where do you kind of walk that fine line between being more tactful and, you know, having come into Jesus moments after a loss like that?
You know, I think that it's actually a really good question, and I don't know. I never understood when after you lose, when a coach, without watching the film, makes a knee-jerk reaction on why you lost the game. I'm not smart enough to sit there on the sideline and go, oh, this is why we're losing. And I can put the whole thing on this particular thing, right? This particular group or person or whatever. Now, I could understand, you know, giving up open, wide open receivers, touchdowns, and turning the ball over three times, and giving up big kick returns. Like, those are obvious things that you could point out after the game and say, we're going to get beat if we continue to do that. But part of me is like, that's pouring salt into a wound. I didn't respond very well as a player to that. Like, that was not what was going to help me not make the mistake the next time. The one thing I learned as a player is that I can't think of many times in my playing career that I knew of a player that tried to make a mistake, right? I intentionally went out there and said, you know what? I'm not going to stay in my lane on kickoff returns so that we can give up a big kickoff return, right? Or kick cover so we can give up a big kickoff return. I'm purposely not going to block that three technique. You know what? I'm just going to not cover the receiver this time. Like, that doesn't happen. So their intent is not to mess up. So I think we have to come out from that perspective is, okay, then why did they mess up? That's why I'm always hard on the coach, right? Did we not communicate this properly? Did we not practice this enough? Did we not have a check in place? Were we surprised by something? Whatever it is, I start with the coach. And then with the player, you know, are we maybe giving them too much? Are we not teaching? Or are they not locked in? You know, a lot of times are they lacking the disciplines for which it takes to be successful? I think you have to watch film to be able to understand that. So I think it's best off to not react for a while, watch the film, digest the film, think through your teaching methodologies, and then approach the player from their perspective and, hey, here's what the film says, and how can we fix this so this doesn't happen again? That's how we're trying to approach it. Hopefully it's a method that works.
Last one to Johnny.
When you guys get gashed like that defensively, 49 points over 460 yards, how much of the next few days is self-scout going back and looking what you did wrong, mm-hmm. and how do you balance that with looking ahead to Louisiana?
Yeah, it's a good question. It's a balance of both. You have to do what you do better. That's the self-scout. You have to see if there are obvious things that are flaws either in personnel or scheme that are being taken advantage of. I think that, well, that did happen yesterday. It's happening right now. And then you have an eye on your next opponent and the challenges they create. You know, the one unique thing about college football that doesn't get talked enough about, and this is a conference that represents, I know we're not in conference play, but our schedule represents this, is you play dramatically different styles too. Especially as a defense, that was a true, you know, spread attack. I'd call it a power spread, 11 personnel spread, but they did play a lot of 10 personnel, which is true spread out formations. That's very different than Louisiana, who's a 12 personnel team. It's a power, play action, run action, move the pocket team. Very different than a Temple or a Navy down further in the schedule, a balanced team like Tulane and UTSA. So you're going to play all these different styles. So a lot of times what happened one week isn't necessarily going to carry over to the next week. There's fits, there's scheme fits that are better one week than the other. So long-winded answer, but I think part two is also not overreacting to, well, okay, we did this poorly, it's going to happen again. Well, no, you can fix the seal in the boat a little bit to make that piece better. But you know what? We actually play this really well. We've done a really nice job for 2 weeks against whatever that thing is. And we're going to see that this week. So I don't know if I'm making any sense, but it's a big picture look at getting better yourself, self-scouting, and looking ahead to your next opponent and what the challenges are and what the advantages are. Because we have some advantages too now. You know, let's not – you don't hear me saying we're chopped liver. I'm not any less bullish than I was before this game on our potential. I'm disappointed in how we played. You have to play well, whether you're good or bad, to win games, and we did not play well in any of the three phases.
Any other questions for Coach?
All right, they're more fun than me anyways. Get Kelly going.
I have a second question I didn't ask last week. I know your youngest daughter's name is Delaney. Yes.
I did not. No, we lived on a Delaney. We live right near Delaney Boulevard in Baltimore. That's where my wife got the name. So when we're in Baltimore, that's how she got it. So, all right, see you guys.